Wow, can we just say amen and go home now? Good. I'll catch a nap before next service. Okay, let me turn this thing on here once. Okay. Well, welcome. I want to thank everybody that covered for me last week. You guys did a really good job, and I watched as much of it as I could every time I was on the top of a hill. I was coming home, and there's not much tower between Alliance and North Platte. So, anyway, thank you. Is this right? The bouncing checks playing at the hall this afternoon, like from 1 to 3 or something like that?
1 to 4.
1 to 4. Okay. Also tonight, of course, is the community cantata practice in the Humboldt Sanctuary, if any of you want to sing. Tuesday, this Tuesday is Fat Tuesday, Shrove Tuesday, and I buy all the pancakes at the Titan Diner. We're still going to have Bible study here, so I'll have to leave a little after 9, but I'll pay for them clear till 10 o'clock. And this year, for the first time, the woman who owns the diner has decided that since all these people are getting free pancakes, maybe they'd like to donate to a charity, and so she's going to put a bucket out for the Humboldt Ministerial Association. I said, well, this isn't a fundraiser. She says, you don't have to do a fundraiser, then I can. I said, okay, whatever. So, Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. We will, that's not right. That's Humboldt that's having the Bible study at 8:30. That's not us, that's Humboldt. But, because our Bible study is on Tuesday at 9:30, like always. Lenten lunches, however, do affect us because that's Pawnee County. And the first one will be at the Pawnee City Zion Lutheran at noon. We will have Ash Wednesday services here. If it's nice and not too windy, and it's supposed to be nice, we will have Ash Wednesday services outside on that cement, like we did that one time when we didn't have any electricity.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to tell you why. Have to come to find out. The Stella Community Church, and you know that's the pastor that's here at the Christian Church too, they're having a spring sing on the 13th. There's going to be performances from more than one church, I think. I'm going to sing a song. And then a soup supper after. If you're interested, you need to call that number and leave a message. That's his office phone. And so, because he's like me, if you call and tell him on his cell phone, he won't remember. So I'll leave a message.
What day is it?
Day of the week?
Yeah.
Well, let's see. Ace Wednesday's on the 2nd, 9th. I think it's probably a Saturday, maybe? I don't know. I can't look at the calendar on my phone because the calendar on my phone is in use right now, so I don't know.
It's a Sunday.
It's a Sunday. Okay, thank you. So here's the list of all the rest of the meals. We're serving here on the 16th, and I didn't have room to put in all the churches that are helping. But this year, not only Burchard, but also the Christian Church is going to help us with our luncheon. So that'll be fun. You're still invited over to Humboldt. If you guys want to go over there early in the morning, they have a full breakfast, a big breakfast at 7 o'clock. 19th is the first day, and of course that's our auction over here, so that's probably not. But you can go to those different churches at 7 o'clock. You'd be welcome and fed well. And ladies, you're always invited to the Methodist Church at 9 o'clock on those same dates, 19th, 26th, 2nd, and 9th. And we have speakers that come in. And we have, they say it's coffee, but it's also usually egg casserole, and it's pretty much brunch. Okay, consignment sale is coming up. Everybody's got all their ducks in a row for that, I'm sure. We only got one celebration. It's Brian Siebel, and he isn't here, but we wish him happy birthday anyway. Let's sing He is Lord. We'll sing it through two times. You can stand if you want to. You don't have to. It's up to you.
He is Lord.
Responsive. Beyond our busyness, above the cold winter floor, there is a glory rising, born of heaven and reaching out to each one of us.
A light that shines through the clouds, an invitation seeking all who we are, that transfigures the world.
That transforms darkness into hope, that brings life from a cross where old life ends, and a new life is born.
In glory, Jesus meets us here, bringing us from the depths of the valley to the height of the mountain, carrying the weight of our humanity to the heights of heaven's glory.
Let us worship from the mountain and hear again, "This is my Son, my chosen. Listen to him." Be Thou My Vision, page 451. It's on page 881, if you want to look it up in your hymnal. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We don't have any kids, so we're going to skip past that. And we're going to sing, "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus," and we'll sing this twice as well, Susan.
And the things of
scripture is from the Old Testament, Exodus 34. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with God. The responsive reading is Psalm 99. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. The Lord sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake.
The Lord is great in Zion, and is exalted over all the peoples.
Let them praise your great and wondrous name.
Holy is the Lord.
Mighty ruler, lover of justice, you have established equity.
You have executed justice and righteousness.
Extol the Lord our God, worship at the Lord's footstool.
Holy is the Lord.
Moses and Aaron were among God's priests. Samuel also was among those who called on God's name.
They cried to the Lord, who blessed them, who spoke to them in the pillar of cloud.
They kept God's testimonies and the statutes God gave them.
O Lord our God,
extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain.
Surely the Lord our God is holy.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Transfiguration. This is Transfiguration Sunday. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. Now, I am going to play a video, and you folks at home are not going to get to see it, and you're probably not going to get to hear it, because Facebook will probably mute it. But if you want to know what I'm playing, it's Linda Randell, and the name of the song is God on the Mountain, so you can Google it later. Whoop, clicked on the wrong thing, let's try again. There we go. That was a good sermon. I can't really improve on that.
I recognize that.
So every year, of course, we have Transfiguration Sunday, and I have to get something that I was going to use for the kids, but that's okay.
But you're
going to
need some candy.
Yeah, I need candy. I need a little more chocolate, some caffeine. And every year, I try to look at the scripture from a little bit different point of view. Because, you know, the Bible has a lot of layers, and we know that. Sometimes we talk about the significance of the fact that it was Moses and Elijah. Because Moses represented the law, and Elijah represented the prophets, and Jesus fulfilled the law and the prophecies. He brought it all together. So sometimes we talk about that. And sometimes we talk about good old impetuous Peter. You know, he's my favorite. And how he thought it was good that he was there. He's going to build him a shelter. As if God Jesus. Or, for that matter, Moses or Elijah, who had already been in their eternity, in their heavenly home for centuries, as if they needed a house. But yeah, he was there for them. So sometimes we talk about that. And sometimes we talk about God basically telling Peter to be still, hush up, listen to Jesus. And those are all valid points. But I want to talk about something different today. We're still in the series called Love Never Ends, and we touched on the endless love of God through resurrection a few weeks ago. We briefly discussed the heavenly body versus the earthly body, and at sometimes how we're obsessed with those books and movies of near-death encounters where they tell us what heaven looked like to them. But I don't suppose that any of us have had a close encounter with someone who has returned from the dead. And maybe neither had the disciples. See, here's the thing. The Gospel of John is the only gospel that mentions Lazarus being raised from the dead. And John is also the only gospel that doesn't mention the Transfiguration. So we don't know which came first, chronologically. We don't know which happened first. But we do know that the disciples were terrified to see Moses and Elijah. So I guess I'm leaning toward a guess that maybe they had never before seen someone dead brought back to life. So maybe, I'm leaning towards maybe this happened before Lazarus was raised from the dead. We don't know. But let me be clear here. Moses and Elijah were not ghosts. And they were not angels. Now, I like a good ghost story as much as the next guy. And I like stories about angels. And I do not dispute anything that I do not understand or that I have not personally seen. But Moses and Elijah in this story were not ghosts or angels. If they would have been, not even Peter would have thought they needed a house. They were men, real men with bodies, but they were not regular bodies. They were different in ways that were indescribable. Now, we read in the Old Testament how after Moses talked to God, he literally glowed. And it was terrifying to the people that saw him. So he put a veil over his face until it kind of calmed down a little bit. But every time he went and talked to God, he would be changed, transformed, transfigured. And that's where they started putting a veil over the front of the temples, because the Holy of Holies, they weren't too much about the whole omnipresent, that God is everywhere. They still thought that they were carrying him around in a gold box, and they were afraid to look at God. Well, God told Moses, you can't see my face, it'll kill you. But they were even afraid to look at people who had talked to God one-on-one. So they put that veil up across the whole front of their tabernacle. It wasn't until Jesus died that that curtain was torn in two and people could once again talk straight to God without fear. Now, Moses and Elijah died centuries before the disciples were born. And although they never had met them, obviously, Peter, James, and John recognized them. There were no paintings, no Polaroids, no Snapchat selfies, and yet the disciples recognized them. That was a miracle in itself. Without the Holy Spirit, they wouldn't have known who was talking to Jesus. If Jesus came to our town square, we likely wouldn't recognize him by sight. We might recognize him with our heart, but he probably looks nothing like these pictures. Probably nothing like them at all. And the same with Moses. He probably isn't a long bearded man with a white robe carrying two stone tablets. You know, I wouldn't think carrying those heavy stone tablets around for eternity would be very much of a reward. That sounds more like a punishment. And how could we possibly recognize Elijah? Would he park a flaming chariot in front of the town hall? No. So this story gives me hope for eternity. It makes me believe that my grandfathers, who died before I was born, will recognize me in heaven, and I will recognize them, even though we've never met. It gives me hope that my grandmother, who died when I was only 5, will recognize me immediately when I get there. The story makes me believe that we won't need name tags in heaven. Now, here on earth, I wish everybody wore name tags. I'm terrible with names, not even that good with faces. But in heaven, it will be different. Our souls and our heavenly bodies will be something so different than what we have down here. And I can't imagine what it would be like, but this story gives me hope. Another thing that I like about this story is that Jesus and Moses and Elijah are having a conversation. I suppose Jesus wanted to hear from them a few details of how things have been going in heaven since he's been gone. Maybe he wanted to know from Moses what it felt like to die. Maybe he just needed to talk to a couple old friends for a little encouragement during a stressful time in his life. Now, Dr. Derek Weber, the director of preaching ministries, postulates, and I quote, "They were there to talk about Jesus' departure, checking his ticket, reminding him of security details, perhaps. No liquids, take all the metal out of your pockets, take off his shoes." Moses said that, I would think. Moses knew about taking off his shoes. No, maybe it was something else, something more. Departure in Greek translates as exodus. Moses knew about exodus. He knew what was to change everything he knew and everything he was, even for an uncertain future. He knew how to embrace that change even through fear. End quote. Jesus had already changed everything he knew, everything, to come to earth. And he was about to change everything he knew again to save us. But whatever they were discussing, what I like is that they were having a conversation. You know, when we read the Revelation, sometimes we kind of get the opinion that all we do in heaven is surround the throne and sing praises to God. Well, that sounds pretty good for a while. But I don't necessarily think that sounds great every second for eternity. Starts to sound kind of boring. I want to think that maybe sometimes we chat with old friends and make new friends, and see loved ones, and talk about the old times, and laugh at the old familiar family jokes. I want to think that we can stop singing praises long enough to eat some of that great food at the wedding feast. You know, one of my hopes in heaven is that food is delicious, and that since we only have to eat for pleasure, we can eat all we want and never pack on the pounds. Doesn't that sound good? The story of the Transfiguration is a sneak peek at our heavenly bodies. Apparently they glow like a solar light. Now, I don't know if that was the case for Moses and Elijah all the time. Maybe only when they were talking to God. Maybe like Moses, when they talked to Jesus, they lit up like a Christmas tree. Jesus is, after all, the light of the world. Jesus is God. And talking to Jesus recharges our batteries, like a solar light. If you leave it in the dark in the closet, it won't light. You have to put it out where it gets some light from the sunshine. Being closer to Jesus spiritually changes everything. Transfiguration is most especially about change. Certainly Jesus, Moses, and Elijah were changed physically. But as we get closer to the beginning of the Lenten seasons, coming right up, just Wednesday is the first day, we too seek a transformation. We want to change how we see the world. We want to change how we act towards people. We want to change how we react to circumstances beyond our control. So a lot of circumstances beyond our control. We want to change how we react to those circumstances. And we want to get so close to Jesus that we see the glory of God. But if we seek mountaintop experiences in order to feel closer to Jesus, we will likely be disappointed. More often, we feel closer to Jesus when we are in the valley of despair. As the song lyrics say, life is easy when you're up on the mountain, but the God of the mountain is still God in the valley. C.S. Lewis, in his book, The Problem of Pain, goes one step further to say, God whispers to us in our pleasure, but shouts in our pain. In other words, when things are the bleakest, we finally hush up and listen for Jesus. We finally turn toward Jesus and draw nearer to him. Now, you all know that in the last few weeks, we've had a lot of deaths in the area. A lot. Todd Deerberger told me yesterday that he has done half a year's work in the last 6 weeks. And that can be pretty depressing. But if we trust in the divinity of Jesus, it changes everything. In our faith in Jesus, we are transformed. Of course we grieve when we lose a friend or a loved one to death, but we are not broken because we have eyewitnesses who have seen the divinity of Jesus. We have eyewitnesses who have seen that there is life after death. That should change the whole perspective of how we view life, and especially on how we view death. Instead of crippling grief, we see the glory of God. Now, I don't think it's likely that I will see Jesus chatting with Moses on the hilltop in Nebraska. But I have full assurance that I will see Jesus and be able to have a conversation with him somewhere, sometime. And I have full assurance that I will see loved ones that I haven't seen for years, and probably some that I have never seen. I have full assurance that I will feast at the table with all the believers. And that is a change in my attitude. That is transformative. As we grow in that faith and assurance, it takes us one step closer to personal transfiguration, until at last we stand face to face with God. No veil, no mask, no division, and see the glory of God, transformed by the light of the world. Amen. Amen. Where have you seen God this week? A quick update. Larry Layden is very, very, very ill. And we're praying for comfort for him as he transitions to his eternal body. And Bernie is doing well. He's still got a lot of pain, of course. That'll take some time. It was a very major surgery, but he's doing well, and we're excited that he'll soon be able to go home. It's good to see Shad here. Came and turned up the heat.
I'm going to ask for prayers for Alan, Claire, and Jean. Claire's got, I think it's laryngitis, that contagious coming.
Oh my goodness.
They've got a problem.
They have been so sick this year. Alan and Claire and Jeannie just pray for them all the time, for their health and comfort and strength and patience. And
thank everybody for the prayers for my brother.
How is that situation going?
2 days later, prayers. I told my brother, I said, prayers work. They were feeling good.
Good.
Good. Not.
Edie's brother, we've been praying for him, well, for a long time. And we continue to pray for him.
And thank everybody for signing up. This is kind of awful now, but signing up for downstairs for...
It's a joy. We'll put that under joy. It's a joy that people come together to bring cakes and salads and whatever they're supposed to bring to make this Lenten luncheon successful. Anything else?
On another note, joy, we went to Ogallala in Lexington last weekend, and we got to see, they had just done a count. There were 130 eagles.
130 bald eagles at Ogallala in Lexington. Oh, man.
It's just an awesome sight to see.
I assume there are pictures. Did you take a lot of pictures?
I did, and I haven't uploaded them yet.
Oh, well, please. I haven't had time to Facebook this week. But I'll watch for those pictures. Absolutely. That is wonderful. I love seeing a bald eagle, and you know, I see one 4 or 5 times a week now. And when I was little, you had to go to a zoo to see a bald eagle. So conservation works.
It's a joy to have you back.
It's a joy to be back. It's a long ways across, corner to corner across Nebraska. I'm assuming that Jeannie is maybe preaching in another church this morning. She did a fabulous job last week, and I'm sure she's doing a great job this week. Let's come into a spirit of silent prayer. Shine on us that we might shine our light to the world. Be with those who are ill and those who are near the end of their earthly life, and those who are recovering from injury or from surgery. Lay your hand of healing upon them and your arm of comfort around them. Be with the families of those who have lost loved ones, and those who are holding a loved one's hand as it gets closer and closer to that time. Comfort them. Let them know that they are not alone. We thank you for the sunshine. We ask that you would bless us with rain. As we go into the Lenten season, help us reevaluate our own lives and see what parts of our lives need to be transformed and transfigured. And then by your Holy Spirit, help us to do that. We also ask that you would be with the troops that are being deployed to the Ukraine. Keep them safe. Please touch the hearts of world leaders that they might not let greed rule their lives, but rather compassion, kindness, cooperation. In all these things, we ask that you would have your way because we don't know what is best. These things and the unspoken prayer we bring to you, and we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Pete, I'm going to pick on you. I picked on Richard last time I was here. Sitting toward the back gets you in trouble. people are still, I don't know how much is coming in the mail now. We still get stuff on PayPal. And, of course, we're still not passing the plate, which the only downside of that is passing the plate, we got to hear one more pretty song. but anyway, we appreciate that, and let's sing the doxology. Blessing. Transforming God, we come to your altar this morning, knowing that in our giving and in our living, we have often put just enough into living our faith so as not to impact our lifestyle or cause too much discomfort. We have been reluctant to let go of our affinity for the things of this world. And in our attachments, we have often missed the opportunity for the transformed lives you desire for us. May our offering this morning be an invitation to living a life radically transformed by your power, love, and grace. We pray this in the mighty love of Jesus. Amen. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Send forth the word.
when I was pregnant for the first time. And I was skinny, so it didn't take me very long to get a baby bump. That's hard to believe, I know. But my mother-in-law told me I was pregnant before I told her. And she said, I can tell because you glow. I think of that when I read the story, how when Moses and Elijah talked to God, both when Moses was still on earth and after he went to his eternal home, they glowed. They were transformed. We should be changed when we spend time in prayer with God, and it should show. So go out in the world and do not put a veil over your face. Sometimes you have to wear a mask, not the same thing. Do not put a veil over your face. Let the light of Christ shine through you and share that light with the world in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Susan.
Thank you. Thank you.
You can just set it in the garage. I mean, if they're going to do it, set it outside.